Okay, let's come back to our image here that depicts the ground roll and takeoff. So we've talked a little bit about the acceleration distance, and we've come up with a closed form first cut approximation for the acceleration distance, and that looks like this. Acceleration distance equals 1.21 w squared divided by rho g sw CL max times T minus D minus friction force, all evaluated at 0.7 times the liftoff speed, 70% liftoff speed. Okay, so this is our approximation for the acceleration distance. And this is all dictated, for the most part, by the aircraft design. And the reason for that is because during the acceleration phase, the aircraft attitude is fixed by the landing gear. So CL is fixed, alpha is fixed, and so the drag coefficient CD is also fixed. And actually, during the acceleration phase, throttle is generally at its maximum setting. Okay, so the throttle setting is also fixed. And we were able to come up with something nice for that. Now, during the rotation phase, the rotation distance is really mostly a function of the pilot. And the reason for that is because we've now accelerated to the liftoff speed, and during the rotation phase, the pilot then inputs some elevator deflection in order to rotate the aircraft up slowly until lift is greater than weight and the aircraft lifts off. But the rate at which the aircraft rotates depends on the amount of elevator input that the pilot uses, and the pilot generally does not use max elevator input. And so we have to kind of make an estimate for how long this takes. So that the rotation time, we're going to just assume it takes somewhere between 1 and 4 seconds, where 1 is typical for like a general aviation aircraft, and 4 is like a really large airplane. Okay, so like 3 would be typical for like a commercial aircraft, and we could be anywhere in between there. Okay, so the rotation distance really depends on pilot input, and because of that, the way that we approximate it, well, and the other thing to note that is that during the rotation phase, the velocity remains constant at the liftoff velocity. And so because of that, we're going to approximate the rotation distance just as the velocity, so that's V liftoff minus V headwind, if we have a headwind, times the rotation time. And that's our approximation for the rotation distance. So, now let's look at our liftoff velocity. So if you recall, the liftoff velocity is just 1.1 times the stall speed, and so it's 1.1 times 2 over CL max times the square root of W over SW, wing loading, divided by rho. So if we plug that in, and we assume no wind, so assume headwind equals 0. So this is for the critical case of no wind. Then we can approximate our rotation distance as SR equals 1.1 times TR root 2 divided by CL max times root W over SW divided by rho. And we're going to box that. So that's our rotation distance. Or at any rate, a good first cut approximation for our rotation distance. Okay, so now if we go up, we have our acceleration distance, we have our rotation distance, and so the ground roll is just the sum of the two. So, we come down here, I'm going to try and keep both of these in the frame. This might be a little bit difficult, but we're going to then say that SG equals SA plus SR, which equals 1.21 W squared divided by rho G SW CL max times T minus D minus FR, all evaluated at 70% of the liftoff speed, plus 1.1 times TR square root 2 over CL max times the square root of W over SW divided by rho. And there we have an approximation, first cut approximation, for the ground roll and takeoff. And give that a cool star. So it's important to remember that we've made a lot of assumptions to get here. Particularly, we assumed that our thrust, drag, and friction force were functions of velocity throughout the entire acceleration phase, parabolic functions with velocity, but that they don't vary very much with velocity, so that we can pull them out and get this expression. We've also assumed that there's no wind, and we've assumed that our liftoff velocity is 1.1 times the stall speed, which is the minimum liftoff velocity allowed by FAR regulations. Okay, now we've derived all of this for a tricycle landing gear aircraft. And for those who aren't familiar, what I mean by that is we have, say we have an aircraft, which again I'll try and draw not too ugly. A high wing this time. Okay, so we have our aircraft. Now a tricycle landing gear is going to have, like the name implies, three wheels about like this. So during our entire takeoff, during the entire acceleration phase, the aircraft attitude is fixed by the landing gear. Okay, and so this is typical of tricycle landing gear. But there's also another configuration, which is tail dragger, which you've likely seen. And in a tail dragger configuration, you look something more like this. All right. Something more like this, where you start off at a high angle of attack and therefore a high lift coefficient. And with a tail dragger, let me come down here a little bit lower. The tail dragger, if this is your airstrip, and you have your tail dragger airplane here. Airplanes are just going to start looking uglier. Okay, so here's your tail dragger. So you start your acceleration phase and you get to some point where, so you start at a really high lift coefficient and a really high angle of attack. And in fact, you're really close to the maximum lift coefficient, and you don't really want to stay there because you have high drag and it's really not a great place to be. But in order to get to a better position, which would look maybe more like what you'd have with tricycle landing gear, something more like this, you have to be going fast enough that when you input elevator deflection, you can rotate the tail up. Okay, so this velocity at which you can finally get control that way is called the minimum ground control airspeed. Okay, so we start at a high lift coefficient, high angle of attack, until we get to the minimum ground control airspeed, at which time our lift coefficient becomes constant and our angle of attack is constant at this attitude here. And then things proceed as they would with a tricycle landing gear. We reach our liftoff speed and we enter a rotation phase, where again the aircraft rotates. And lift increases until takeoff, at which time lift begins to exceed the weight and the aircraft leaves the ground. Wow, okay, that's really ugly, but you get the idea. So basically all we've done here is added this extra phase where the lift coefficient and angle of attack are fixed at a high lift coefficient angle of attack configuration. Then the aircraft rotates to a lower lift coefficient, lower angle of attack, constant configuration until we reach a rotation phase and then the takeoff. So all we've done here is just added this extra term. And during this phase, we can apply all the same equations as we did during the phase that was similar to tricycle landing gear. Okay, so this is what we get with a tail dragger.